praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We want to bless the name of God for giving us the opportunity to be here today. And I believe that in your various rooms where you are watching me now, I believe that you are with your Bible and your Sunday school perfect. I want you to call your friends, your children to join you. Just tell them, Happy Easter celebration. Happy Easter celebration. God will bless each and every one of us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Our God and our Lord, we bless you for this morning. We thank you for the opportunity given to us to learn at your feet one more time. Daddy, we say be exalted in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
As we proceed in the lesson, you come and be our teachers in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank you, everlasting Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
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 First and foremost, we want to appreciate the authority of this church for giving us the opportunity to have this Sunday school for this year. God in the administration of man. God in the administration of man, that's what we have been looking at from the beginning of this year even to this point, which was divided into three modules. The first part, that is God leading through the priest, then the second part through the judges, and the last part, which is through the kings. Now we have finished the first aspect. We are looking at the second aspect through the judges. And today we are moving straight to lesson seven. Lesson seven, which says God rules through Gideon and Jephthah. Can you just tell anybody around you? God rules through Gideon and Jephthah. Let's say it together.
God rules through Gideon
and Jephthah. Yes. Now, our text is taken from the memory scripture is taken from the book of Judges, chapter 6, verse 14. Judges chapter 6, verse 14. Then the Lord turned to him and said, Go in this might of yours, and you shall save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have I not sent you? Have I not sent you? Now, this is a scripture that this is the person that God told Gideon, that go in this thy might. The lesson is divided into two parts. The first part, which we are going to look at this week, is Gideon. Okay, Gideon, a man of valor. Then by next week, by God's grace, we'll be looking at Jephthah, a man of his word. Jephthah, a man of his word. Before we go further, let's quickly look at the devotional thoughts. The devotional thought says, God will turn every situation around to suit his purpose among men for his glory and their blessing. God will turn every situation around to suit his purposes among men for his glory and their blessing. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Now, today's lesson is divided into two parts again. Leads God's people to victory. That is Gideon. Leads God's people to victory. Then, the second part says, leave a bad legacy, however. However, he left a bad legacy. He led the people of God to victory. Now, if you quickly look at the book of Judges chapter 6, from verse 11, as usual, the Israelites, after they have been delivered over and over, they turn back again, and they turn back and follow another God. From there, the Midianites oppressed them for about 7 years. They were under the oppression of the Midianites, to the extent that these people were hiding under the caves, some hiding under the stones. The oppression was too much for them. And one day, angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon and said, Gideon, a mighty man of valor, that Gideon, you are a hero. Now, Gideon was surprised. He said, if the Lord is with me, how come that people have been tormenting us? He was seeing himself as a little man, as nobody. But God, in the record of God, God saw him as a hero. I want to tell anybody around, tell the person, don't look down on yourself. Don't look down on yourself.
Don't look down
you
on
are
yourself.
A hero. In the hero. Profile of God, God created Gideon as a hero. But he was looking at himself as just a common man. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Now, when this oppressor was mocked, God sent a prophet to them. God sent a prophet to them who reminded them of good things that the Lord had done for them. How he took them out from Egypt, how they crossed the Red Sea, even me and you today. By the time it looks as if the devil is having the upper hand, we have to look back at our life. Look at how God has helped you over the years. Look at how he has seen you through so many challenges. That same God will not leave you alone. He has invested so much on you to just come and abandon you here for one coronavirus to kill you. It's not possible. God has invested so much on you. Tell yourself, say, God has invested so much on me.
God has invested so much on
me. He cannot allow me to waste my life at this point.
He cannot allow me to waste my life at this point.
Now, God, this prophet now commissioned Gideon into the war. The Bible says in the book of John chapter 14, verse 18, say, no, I will not leave you as an orphan. That is the truth. God will never leave us as an orphan. God will bless us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I say God will bless us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Like I have said, stop making excuses. You don't need to make excuses that see, I'm from the least family. And just like Gideon, he said, I'm from the least family. I am from the least tribe. He gathered so many least. Don't look at that. You have one ability, and that is God. Since you have God by your side, you can do anything. Say, I can do anything.
I can do anything.
With God, I can do anything.
With God, I can do anything.
Now, later Gideon, he went to his household. He went to his household in the night. Then he put down all their idols. He put down all the idols. Now, if you look at it, for God to rule in our life, we need to pull down so many idols. He pulled down the idols, even in his household. He pulled them down. He destroyed them in the night. When people woke up in the morning, they were angry. Ah, how come? Who has done all these terrible things? They were angry. Later, they discovered that it was Gideon. And they planned to, the people challenged him. They wanted to fight him. They called his father, Joas, see, hand over your son to us. Then he now said, what was his offense? They said he had pulled down the idol of Baal. Say, now are you now the lawyer of Baal? Are you the one that will fight for Baal? Why not allow Baal to fight for himself? God will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
They said because of that, they even named him Jerubal. Let Baal fight for himself. God will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Later, Gideon called on all the people that are ready to go into war with the Midianites. And 32,000 people showed up. Now, if you can look at this story very well, 32,000 people showed up for somebody who said he was the least in his family. When he said, I need people that will follow me to war, 32,000 said, we are ready. But before he was running away from all those small enemies. But 32,000 soldiers, they said, see, we are ready to follow you. 32,000, like I said, stop looking down on yourself. People are waiting for a manifestation. And this year, even in the midst of this crisis, you are going to manifest.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
But God told Gideon, he said, see, these people, they are too much. Reduce them. Then Gideon told them, say, if you are not ready for this war, go back. And 22,000 left, leaving 10,000. God said, they are too much. And these people, they are too much. Help me reduce them. I want to reduce them. It's not as if God cannot give them victory through those people. But God wants them to know that they are not the one doing the battle. He was the one that is going to fight the battle. It's not by their strategies. At the end of the day, Gideon obeyed. Like our hymn told, hymn 452, that says, just obey. When God asks you to do something, all you need to do is what? Just obey. Gideon obeyed. No, you are going to the war and they ask to reduce the population. Just obey. It may not make sense to you, just obey. When God asks you to do something, he knows what he wants to achieve from it. Just obey. Tell your friend, just obey.
Just obey.
Now, after that, God gave them victory and he delivered the people. The second part of the lesson said, he left, leaves a bad legacy, however. If you go through that Judges chapter 8, from verse 22 to 35, you will see the detail of the story. Then Gideon made it into an effort and set up in the city, Ophrah, and all Israel played the harlot with it. It became a snare to Gideon and to his household. What I want to say is this, no matter how, even if your leader is getting results, don't idolize your leader. It is God that is doing the work. You are not the one doing the work, it is God that is doing the work. Don't idolize. After the victory, people so much fell in love with Gideon, they said, please come and be our leader. Please come and be our leader. But he said no. But there is something there too that we can still learn, that when you get a result, definitely people will want to follow you. Even Jesus Christ, when after feeding them the next time, they said, yes, you are supposed to be our king. You are supposed to be our king. They said, be our leader. He said no. But he set up a memorial. A memorial was in place for them, which God did not send him. He built an altar. Then the Bible said they prostitute themselves with the gods, which was not part of God's agenda for him. I pray me and you will not fail in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And it became a trap for both Gideon and his family and the entire Israel. Beware of what you are building. Tell your friends, beware of what you are building. Don't build bad legacy for the generation that is coming. Don't build bad legacy for your children. Don't build bad legacy for your children's children. If you can look at it in the book of chapter 9 of that same Judges, verse 15, one of his bastard sons, because at the end of the day, he gathered so many wives, one of his bastard sons killed almost 70 of his children in one day. That is the result of bad legacy. 70 children in one day. May that one never be my portion. That will not be your portion.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Conclusively, we have so many things to learn. One, at any point in life, if you turn back to God, that is, no matter how far you might have gone in the world or even in the sin, if you turn back to God, God is ready to accept you. God is ready to take you back. The Midianites, they have been oppressed by the Midianites, but they turn back and God accepted them. If you are ready to turn back today, God will take you back. May you be blessed in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
What you need, another thing is that what you need is already in you. Don't look at your stature, don't look at your color, don't look at your height, don't look at your geographical location, don't look at your clan, don't look at your family. Everything that you need to succeed is already in you. God is looking at you with what he deposited. He knows what he has put here. He knows what, he knows the resources in you. He knows everything. So everything that you need is already in you. Don't think that maybe it's somewhere. God will help us in Jesus' name. The other thing is that don't focus on your weakness. Focus on God. Tell the person beside you, say, don't focus on your weakness. Focus on God. Focus on God.
Focus on God.
Value your relationship with God. Value your relationship with God. And lastly, to go far in life, you need Jesus. Without him, you can get anything you need in life. Without him, you cannot amount to anything in life. Without Jesus in your life, you cannot amount to anything. If not for God in the life of Gideon, he would have died a pauper, he would have died as nobody. But because of God in his life, he achieved his purpose. May you achieve your purpose. In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
God did not abandon these people alone. He's still interested in them. Even you, even in the midst of these challenges, God is still interested in us. He has not abandoned us. God bless us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Our work to do, you can send it to us on any of our social media for any comment or for any suggestion. God will bless you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Father, in the name of Jesus Christ,
amen.
We thank you, Lord God, for the success of this lesson this morning. That you receive the exalted in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Lord, we pray, oh Lord, that the grace, the power, the ability to focus on you, to focus on you and see ourselves even the way you see us. God, you will release the grace unto us in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank you, everlasting Father.
Thank you, Jesus.
As we go this week, the death and the resurrection of Jesus over our life will not be in vain in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And the presence of God will go with us.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen. Amen. With the choir, we have a very short rendition this morning, and it's titled, He Has Risen. As you listen to us, may you be blessed in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you.
Easter celebration. Shall we pray? My dear Lord Jesus, we bless your holy name. We give you thanks, we give you praise, we give you honor, we give you all glory. For it has pleased you to have granted us this grace to celebrate this year 2020 Easter celebration. But bless your holy name for every life, for every viewer, for every hearer of this message. Father, we say be exalted, Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Father, it is time we want to go into your word. Spirit of the Most High God, minister to us live.
Amen.
And let there be transformation.
Amen.
Jesus' name have I prayed.
Amen.
And amen.
Amen.
Lord, the church says the Lord, amen.
Amen.
Once again, we bless the name of the Lord. Thank God for another privilege to celebrate this year, 2020, Easter. It is the Lord's way, and it is marvelous in our sight. Many things have been happening in this nation, not only in this nation. Many things have been happening around the globe. But we want to thank God for His mercy, endure it forever. The devil has already lost the battle. He has been a loser right from the foundation of the earth, and he will continue to lose.
Amen.
Whether you are inside celebrating the Easter, whether you are only with your family, what is important is that this year Easter celebration does not meet you inside the grave. Can you shout a big hallelujah for that?
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
So by the grace of God, today, I will be ministering on a topic entitled Redemptive Power of Christ. Redemptive Power of Christ. Join me in the book of 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I want to read from verse 14 to 19. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty, and your faith is also empty. Yes. And we have found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that He raised up Christ, whom He did not raise up. Even if the dead do not rise. Verse 16. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then also those who are falling asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life we have hope in Christ, we are all men the most pitiable. Join me with him again, the book of Isaiah. Let's open our Bible to the book of Isaiah, chapter 53. Isaiah chapter 53. We want to read from verse 4 to 5. Isaiah 53, verses 4 to 5. I read from NIV. Surely He took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows. Yet we consider Him stricken by God, smitten by Him, and afflicted. But He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon Him, and by His wounds we are healed. Don't forget, redemptive power of Christ. The word redemption means deliverance from bondage based on the payment of a price. by the Redeemer. And it means deliverance from bondage based on the payment of a price by the Redeemer, which implies that before redemption can take place, somebody must have paid a price on behalf of that person that is in bondage. From here, we know that the entire man race, we are in bondage as a result of this of sin committed by Adam, the first Adam. The Bible says that we have all sinned, Romans 3:23, and come short of the glory of God. Because sin that man committed in the Garden of Eden, he has put us in bondage. He has made us to be under the captives of the devil. And for this very reason, Jesus Christ has come. No wonder the Bible says that it's for this purpose I have come. He said the Son of God has manifested to destroy the works of darkness. And he said that he came to his own in the book of John chapter 1. And his own believe him not, but as many that have believed him, he has given them the power to become the sons of God. Which means that his purpose is to redeem us from slavery, from the power of darkness. I'm talking about the redemptive power of Christ. We have sold ourselves into slavery by sin. Ladies and gentlemen, look at what is happening in the world now. Everybody now is living, virtually living in fear of coronavirus as a result of sin. Sin has brought this untold affliction to the entire world. And this is very reason this particular time is very, very important. And this is one of the main reasons Christ came to suffer, to die, and to resurrect. I so much believe in the power of Christ because he has redeemed us from slavery. The Bible says, it is written, woe unto him that is hanged on tree. He became a curse so that we can be set free. Therefore, I want to tell you this morning, at any time you are viewing this world, that Christ has come to redeem us from the power of slavery. And the climax of the redemption is what we are commemorating today, the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the climax of the redemptive power of Christ. I want us to open our Bible again to the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 9, from verse 12 to 15. Hebrews chapter 9. Again, I will read from a New International Version. He did not enter by means of the blood of goats and calves, but he entered the most holy place once for all by his own blood, having obtained eternal redemption. Emphasis, having obtained eternal redemption. The blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a heifer sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean, sanctify them, so that they are outwardly clean. Verse 14. How much more then with the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our conscience from acts that lead to death, so that we may serve the living God. For this reason, Christ, the mediator of a new covenant, that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance. Now that he has died as a ransom to set them free from sins committed under the first covenant. First Adam brought death. The second Adam, the Lord Jesus Christ, has brought life. Like that place that we read, it says, he has come to ransom them from sins committed under the first covenant. And that is what the Lord Jesus Christ has come to do. Whenever redemption takes place, a price must be paid. Anytime redemption is taking place, there must be a tag, a price tag. And the price tag for you and I to be redeemed is the power in the blood of Jesus. It's the blood of Jesus. Like I've read that Hebrews chapter 9, verse 15. It says, for this reason Christ, the mediator of a new covenant, that those who are called may receive the promise eternal inheritance now that he has died as a ransom through the shedding of his blood on Mount Calvary. He was able to redeem us. I'm talking about the redemptive power of Christ through the blood he shed on Mount Calvary. Oh! You know, like Isaiah that we have read, he was bruised. He was flogged. That in my stripes, okay. You know, the way it was being illustrated, like a line razor blade on a rod, and as they are beating, they are drawing it. Blood was crushing out. That was the price to redeem the entire race from the hand of the devil. Price was paid. And that is why I'm so glad at this moment for the entire race that to say it, that Christ has redeemed us. Do not be afraid of any sickness. Do not be afraid of anything. The power of Christ is enough, is able to liberate us, to redeem us spiritually and physically. And today, to you that you are hearing me, by the reasons of the power in the redemption of Christ, as many people that have been held captive, the power of Christ will liberate you all in the name of Jesus Christ. Why? What are the need for redemption? Need for redemption. Why do you need to be redeemed? Why did I need to be redeemed? Number one, man is helpless and powerless. Man has found himself in an hopeless situation. We are so helpless. We are so powerless. So we cannot help ourselves. And that is the reason Christ needs to come to bail man out, to release us from the land of captivity. Number two, of the reason for our redemption, that is, man cannot deliver himself. Conventionally, if somebody gets to court, and after that the person is being detained or remanded in prison, they will tell you, go and bring somebody that will bail you. In most cases, they will tell you that you can't bail yourself. Although there are some special a condition that they can say, okay, because we have known you, you can go. But on general note, somebody needs to come to pay you out. So man cannot deliver himself. Every attempt for man to look for solution by himself has been proved abortive. You know, man tried to go and look for idol to worship, to liberate them, it failed. Now, for that very reason, we need redemption. Number three, why we need redemption. Man is in the state of obscurity. Man is in darkness. Like the Bible said in the book of Genesis, he said darkness covered the whole earth. Man, they were, you know, man was in the state of obscurity. They don't know where they are heading to. And that's why we need to be redeemed by the Lord Jesus Christ. Prevent on you too. You are hearing this word. You don't even know the pattern. You don't even know the direction you are heading to. You need redemption. This is the reason why Christ came. He died and resurrected on the third day. You too, you must be redeemed. The first reason why we need redemption is blood of goats. Our sheep cannot fully atone for the sins of mankind. See, in the Old Testament, the Lord gave it as a law, as an instruction, when man commits, when you commit anything, you bring a sheep, it will be slaughtered, you know, the blood will be atoned. No, the blood can only cover your sin. The blood of sheep or goat does not cleanse your sin. And that is why we need redemption. We need redemption. The Bible says, without shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. In the book of Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22, it says, in fact, the law requires that nearly everything be cleansed with blood. And without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. So blood of God cannot atone for us. And for us to be redeemed, Christ needs to come. Christ came in summer so that we can have life. And that we may have it in an abundance. I pray for you that you are hearing me this moment. The blood of Jesus we are told for you.
Amen.
I said the blood of Jesus we are told for you.
Amen.
The blood of Jesus we are told for you.
Amen.
I said the blood of Jesus we cleanse you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Because the blood of God or she cannot fully atone for our sins. That's the reason why we need the redemption through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let me quickly go to the benefits of redemption. The benefits of redemption. You know why? We cry suffer like this. Why will it sacrifice our loss if there are no benefits for us? Why will Christ, why will he leave? He left his throne. He left the place of comfort. He left his home. He became homeless in this world. If there are no benefits for it, then there is no need for Christ to have suffered a lot. He suffered too much for you and I. Number one, reason why we must be redeemed is for the salvation of our soul. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not yourselves, it is the gift of God. We need salvation, and there is no way we can get salvation. There is no way you and I can be saved except through the redemptive power of Christ. It is through the redemptive power of Christ that brought salvation to mankind. The essence of all the redemption, the essence for the suffering on the Golgotha, the essence of death, oh, that gory death, that painful death, the essence of it is for you and I to be saved. You are listening this hour. I do say, you are not saved until you are saved. If you have not given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, I pray the death and resurrection of Christ will not be in vain in your life. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You need to give your life to Jesus so that you can be saved. Why many people are only entered scattered today is because they are yet to be saved. Make sure you are saved. Number two, benefit is it brought healing. The redemptive power of Christ brought healing to mankind. The Bible says, by his stripes we are healed. By the stripes of Christ we are healed. Through the blood of Jesus we are healed from any form of infirmities, from every deadly disease. I want to challenge every here and viewer. Most especially the challenges we are facing in the world about the pandemic called coronavirus. Jesus has settled it on the cross. You know, in suffering, the shedding of blood here has brought healing to us. What we need to do is to call upon him. I do not subscribe to it that we should not call upon God at this time. This is the time that we need to call upon him for God to heal us. Because our sin and our problem is, we need to cry the Lord, come and heal us. Because of the blood you shed on Mount Calvary, heal us. Heal us, oh God. And I want to tell you, Jehovah Rama, Jehovah Shaman is alive. He will heal us. After the power and the blood of Jesus, I prophesy again to this land. I prophesy to this our race, to the entire world. Receive healing from every power of coronavirus in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The redemptive power of Christ brought healing. There's no sickness in your body now that Jesus does not have the power to heal. Don't forget in the Bible, a woman with the issue of blood for 12 years, touching the garment, the hem of the garment of Christ, she was healed completely. Peter and John, in the book of Acts chapter 3, when you were going, they saw the man crippled. By the resurrection power of Christ, the crippled man was brought back and he was walking on his 2 feet, 2 legs. With this to tell you that Christ can heal. I don't know what they have told you, but the doctor has told you. It happened to me. Sometimes I've shared it in the congregation. I was told by them that I have a sickness. And I told you, say, okay, what is the kind of, what's the name? You know, one thing I love the medical people is that they will give it name. They will give everything happen. They have names for it. And they said, this is the name. That do you know that this one, they will, you will be on drugs every day for a year. I laughed. I left the hospital. And I did not go back after 1 year. One of our members, an evangelist, I went to him. After I conducted tests, he confirmed what they have said in the hospital. And he told me, that's how. This thing is a very serious matter. I need to go for treatment immediately. I said, I helped. I abandoned him. I abandoned the hospital for 1 year. After 1 year, I went back to that hospital. Just because it's a long story. In fact, I was asked to do series of tests. All the series of tests I did by then confirmed that I'm suffering from that healing. But after 1 year, when I went back, I was asked to do tests. I did it again. The doctor asked me and said, so which treatment? Who's giving you the treatment? We have been receiving treatment. I told him emphatically, I did not go anywhere for treatment. But what has happened? The power of redemption, the power of Jesus has healed me. Hallelujah. And to the glory of God, in this moment I'm talking to you, I am completely healed. I went to that evangelist, oh yeah, go and do the test. When he did it, he told me that, well, Pastor, you are free. Listen and listen clearly this hour. Whatever infirmities or sickness in your body, by the power and the blood of Jesus, I prophesy healing in the name of Jesus Christ. Number two, that redemption does for us is he gives us victory. Oh, I love this song. I am a victorious. Yes, I am a victorious. Glory be to God. He has given us victory, victory.
I am victorious.
Yes, I am victorious. Glory be to God. He has given us victory. I'm not hearing you. Sing it louder. Hey. I am victorious. Yes, I am victorious. Glory be to God. He has given us victory. Oh, victory. I am victorious. Corinthians 15:57 says, but thanks be to God. He gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. And number four, through the redemptive power of Christ, we have power to make wealth. He is the one that has given us the power to prosper. True, because we have been redeemed from slavery, then you can prosper. You have been delivered from a curse of poverty. Once more, you align yourself with the Lord Jesus Christ. Prosperity is yours. You can read 2 Corinthians 8:9 later. The fifth one, deliverance. Through the deadly power of Christ, we are delivered. Oh, I would like us to read Galatians chapter 3. The book of Galatians chapter 3. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Galatians chapter 3, verse 3. You see that through Jesus Christ, through the Lord Jesus, we have been delivered. We have been delivered by the power of Christ. Galatians chapter 3, verse 13. He said, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. It is written, curse is everyone who is hung a tree. Verse 14 of Galatians chapter 3. He redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might have come to us. So, through redemption, we have deliverance. And Colossians 2:14 says, everything written against us, he has completely nailed them on the cross. And then the next one, the sixth one, we have justification. We are justified. Nobody can lay any accusation against us again. Wow! Bible says, book of Romans chapter 8. Now, therefore, there is no condemnation in those ones that are in Christ Jesus. For as many people that have been redeemed by Christ, they are justified. Shout hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
Next, through the redemption, through the redemptive power of Christ, we will reign with him eternally. We will reign with Christ eternally. In the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 15. 1 Corinthians, chapter 15, verse 17. I say, and if Christ has not been raised, your faith is in futile, and you are still in your sins. He said, those who are dead, those who also are falling asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are more to be pitied more than all men. Now, verse 20. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruit of those who are falling asleep. Which means that since Christ is the first to be asleep, victory over death. We have victory over death. Jesus said, it is finished. And the same book of 1 Corinthians, our Lord Jesus Christ said, death, where is your power? Grave, where is your victory? Jesus has given us victory over death. And that is why we have hope of eternal life. We know one day, even if we leave this world, we will still resurrect one day. You know, for as many people who have been redeemed by Christ, death has no power over them. We can sleep in this world when our ghost, when the ghost disappear, we will sleep. And when during the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, we will raise up. We have victory over death. Death has no power over us again because of the power of redemption. And as I'm writing it up, come please with me. They that have been redeemed by Christ, they have this hope that when Christ shall come second time, they will fly with him. Which means that they have assurance of eternal life when Christ shall come. When Christ shall come back, we will be with him eternally. By then, we will be with him. Like the Bible says in the book of Revelation, I saw a new heaven and a new heart. The old one disappeared. And in that place, there shall be no sickness. There shall be no coronavirus. There shall be no weeping, no cleansing of teeth. No problems shall be there. Oh, I'm appealing to you. You need to be there. And the only condition, the main condition, is that you must be redeemed. You must be redeemed. You must accept the redemption power of Christ. The work he did on the cross, you must accept it. And after you have done that, I'm assuring you, you will reign with him eternally. You will reign with Christ eternally. You and I will reign with him when he shall come back again. Once again, I congratulate you for seeing this year and celebrating this year Easter. I pray if Christ tarries, we shall celebrate more in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Oh, I am victorious. Yes, we are victorious. Glory be to God. He has given us victory. Victory.
We are victorious.
Oh, yes.
Yes, we are victorious.
Oh,
glory be to God. He has given us victory.
Oh, victory.
We are victorious.
Oh, yes.
Yes, we are victorious.
Glory be to God.
He has given us victory.
Oh, victory.
We are victorious.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, we are victorious.
We came to declare the victory in the name of the Lord Jesus. God has given us victory. By the redeeming power of Christ.
We are victorious.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, we are victorious. Glory be to God. He has given us victory.
The redemptive power of Christ. If you have not given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, bow down your head wherever you are. Bow down your head. Absence of Christ in one's life is the presence of crisis in that person's life. You need to call upon Jesus so that he will redeem you today. You know, I won't wish that you give your life to Christ now. Make up your mind that Jesus entered my life. I know that you are the Lord. I know you came to this world to save me. You suffer for my sake. Lord, today, here am I before you. Save my life. Forgive me all my sins. Cleanse me by your power. Write my name in the book of life. And make me your son, your daughter, forever. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, in Jesus' name, we are praying.
Amen.
I congratulate you. You have made a good decision. And continue to watch you with the body of Christ. This is a very, 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 very special time. Precious time in Christianity. The period of resurrection. And I declare to your life, as you have made up your mind to give your life to Jesus, I pray that the name of the Lord Jesus Christ Your salvation is sure in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You are saved forever.
Amen.
Your name is written in the book of life.
Amen.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Jesus.
Everybody, I want to pray for you wherever you are. Oh, Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Father, we thank you.
Thank you, Jesus.
This is your word. For this very reason, the Son of God manifested to destroy the work of darkness. Every work of darkness in every life. This is why you suffer. They carry, you know, the crown of thorns on your head. Blood was gushing out. Oh God, this is the reason why you suffer all this. Then why will devils still be holding this life in captive? I declare, as many that have been held in captive by the devil, you are set free in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
By the redemptive power of Christ, you are free.
Amen.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Jesus.
And once again, I prophesy to the entire world, you are delivered from every power of evil ones in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I deliver the entire world from the power of coronavirus in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And has come to you.
Amen.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Jesus.
The entire world will be at peace.
Amen.
Receive peace.
Amen.
Receive peace.
Amen.
Receive peace.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Jesus.
In Jesus' name have I prayed.
Amen.
Once again, happy Easter celebration. My name is Pastor Emmanuel Adereme from Christ Apostolic Church, English Assembly, Gogolada District, under the leadership of Pastor Emmy Akane. God bless you. Amen.